Namaste, and I'm really happy to be with you here today on International Yoga Day. I've been with Intact on the yogic journey for the last couple of years, and we've had a chance to be together last year and the year before that. So looking forward to a slightly different way of approaching yoga today. The last two times we spoke about Nad Yoga in particular, but this time we will be speaking on Integral Yoga. So what is Integral Yoga? And how do we understand yoga in a way that affects our lives today? How can we adopt yoga in our lives? How can we understand the integrality given what is happening in our lives today, the great crises that we are facing in many ways, not just the health crises, but the emotional crises, the psychological crisis, the mental crisis, the logistical crisis. There are many, many kinds of wars that we are fighting, both outwardly and inwardly. And how can we understand yoga and use it in our lives to come into union with ourselves? Because that indeed is what yoga means, the supreme union of the self with all its planes and parts. The word yoga comes from the root word yuj, which means union or to unite. What do we unite? What is this union about? It is the union of all the aspects of our consciousness within us, around us, our extensions, and our place with this universe in which we live. So to begin with, before we get to the tools that we can use, the yogic tools that we can use to heal ourselves, to harmonize ourselves, to empower ourselves, let us understand yoga from our existential perspective. And here I would like to bring in a few concepts. There are many, many, many definitions of yoga in our culture by various people, by various practices, by various ways of approaching the self. Whether it is through Hatha Yoga, definitions by Patanjali, definitions in the Atharvaveda, and so on. So I will just mention a couple of definitions of yoga for you today. And one is, of course, what we read in by Patanjali, and he says, yoga chitta vritti nirodha. Yoga chitta vritti nirodha. Now, what does that mean? Vritti means vibration, movement, away from stillness. And yoga is to become still, to remove that unordered or uncontrolled movement or vritti of one's chetna, one's consciousness, one's chitta. The bed of consciousness, which includes the play of the mind, which includes all the thoughts, which includes the subconscious, which includes many layers of our psychological, mental, emotional, pranic, physiological consciousness. So when we learn and practice through great tapasya, moment by moment, day after day, year after year, life after life, when you practice that control, which makes us choose when to move and when to not move, which makes us be still while we are in the movement, is the ultimate aim of yoga, the ultimate aim of the supreme union of all our different parts, all our different selves, with the Supreme Self within. So that's one definition. And now I will mention another very beautiful and interesting definition by Sri Aurobindo. What does he say? He says, all life is yoga. All life is yoga. Now, how do we understand that in this present scenario that we're living in? To understand that, I will bring in an idea from the Ishupanishad. Okay? So there's a line, and these are sets of three verses, but I will just introduce a few lines. Andham tamah pravishyanti ye avidyam upasate tato bhuya ivate tamo yau vidyayam rata. What does that mean? Now he has used, the Rishi has used two words, vidya and avidya. Now when we think of vidya and avidya, typically we think of these two words as knowledge and ignorance. Yes? Now if we go deeper into the understanding of what is vidya in life and what is avidya in life, the definitions are as follows. Vidya is the understanding of the oneness of or the holographic nature of all that is, of the source energy that controls everything, of the oneness of energy that pervades everywhere, of the harmony of being with the forces around us and within us. So typically, when we are in Vidya, when we become enlightened, when we realize the truth, then we realize all these things, and not only realize it, we become Sayujya with it. We become unified with it. We become identified not just in thought, but right down to the physiological, cellular level. And we have heard in the past that when people become Sayujya, when they become every object by complete identification, when there is a unification of consciousness, by complete identification with all that exists, then we have heard in the past that yogis can change form, they can lose form, they can become transparent, invisible, they can take on forms, etc. And very often we think these are just stories, but with more and more and more scientific research, we realize that the nature of every cell, the nature of every atom in our body is really vibrational. And if it is vibrational, then we change the frequency of vibrations, forms can change. So of course, today our aim is not to see how we can change our outward form, but it is to see how we can change our inner self so that our outer circumstances can be controlled and we can come into harmony with life and its different plays and our different plays and parts. So, I define vidya right now. What is avidya? Avidya is the consciousness of division. This is different from that, is different from that, is different from that, and all these things are in opposition with each other. When you face a sense of opposition, a sense of negativity, a sense of division with the different parts of your life, with the different plays of your life, with the different people in your life, then you are said to be avidya. Also, the breaking up of your own being into different plays, into different manifestations, into the diversity of life, into the diversity of consciousness, is also defined as avidya, sometimes called maya. Like the colors of the rainbow, the truth is white light, but the colors of the rainbow sometimes appear and disappear and appear and disappear. So we say those colors actually are a maya. They come and they go, but the real thing is the white light. But how beautiful is the rainbow? Could we do without it? So similarly, how beautiful are our creative pursuits, our movement towards perfection, our strivings towards making our lives more beautiful, more meaningful? That's the play of avidya, and yet it's beautiful, sometimes not beautiful. So that's why the Upanishad says, those who follow the diverse play alone go into a great tamasic darkness. But those who follow just the oneness alone, just following into a meditative state, those who run away from the diversity of life, go into a greater darkness. So that's very interesting. They are saying by vidya, you go into a greater darkness, while with avidya, you go into a darkness. And the solution to that in the Upanishad is given as a few lines, and then they say, avidyayam mrityum tirtva avidyayam amritam ashnute. So let me explain that again before we come to the tools. This is a little bit of philosophy. From philosophy, we will come to an understanding of ourselves and then use tools which will help us. Yoga bhyas. Well, what we call yoga is actually yoga bhyas, which means exercises, inner and outer exercises, which lead us towards union, lead us towards yoga. So why are we saying through vidya we will go beyond mrityu in the Upanishad, and by avidya we will enjoy amritam, immortality? And the line before that says that he who understands both avidya and vidya as one will go beyond death by vidya, and by avidya enjoy amritam, immortality. So what does that mean? Now, when you understand that everything that is impermanent, like your skin, for instance, is dying at every moment. Your cells are being washed off every time you have a bath. Every day, every moment, your cells are dying. So your body is dying every moment from the time you are born. And yet we say, we are alive. What is it that is alive? Not this body, which is made up of cells. Everything is made up of cells. You have mind cells, you have skin cells, you have tissue cells, you have bone cells. Everything is made up of atoms and molecules which make cells, etc. But these cells are dying every moment. So you are dying every moment. But yet you are not dying, because you're thinking, you're learning. Whatever you learn since childhood gets retained in your memory. And you grow and you evolve and so on. So what is that you that evolves? That you that evolves is something that is beyond this form, beyond this skin. Vayuranilam amritam athedam bhasmantam shariram om krito smara kritam smara krito smara kritam smara. Vayuranilam, that pranic being, that pranic reality, is amrit, amrit, nectar, or amrit, non-dying. Bhasmantam shariram, of this body, ashes are the end. Or every moment, your cells, your body is going back to the elements. Om krito smara kritam smara krito smara kritam smara. O will, O agni, O self, remember that where you have come from or what you are, that which was done, that which has happened in your process of evolution for ages, remember. So this is a call by the Rishi to the self, and a call for all of us to go back to who we truly are. So that is called vidya. So when you are in that vidya, that this is impermanent, everything is in flux, everything is ever changing, something new is being born every moment, and something old is going. In fact, today is the day of the solar eclipse. We know that during eclipses, many new species are said to be born and many old bacteria, species, etc. perish. There's a change in the rays. Many things happen to the human body. So it's a very interesting day today where this truth is so stark for us. So becoming a part of Vidya, getting into Vidya, makes us go beyond the idea of one life and one death. Makes us understand that this whole play of life and death, of something being created, something being maintained, something perishing, the Trinity, which we also call Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh, or Srishti, Sthiti, and Samhara, is going on all the time, at every moment of our lives. So when we learn to play with this Trinity, we are in Vidya. I've lost a job. There are infinite more possibilities. Let me not feel dejected, feel as if I've lost, just because one Sthiti has dissolved into Samhara. One Sthiti has gone, but a new Srishti can be made. So that is where you come into Vidya. And through that Vidya, you cross over the idea of loss, the idea of death, the idea of dissolution, the idea of having gone to a level which has no repair. So that is what Vidya does to us. But through avidya, the Upanishad says, Amritam Ashrute, you enjoy non-death, you enjoy immortality. How do you enjoy immortality? What is immortality? How is immortality different from going beyond death? Through Vidya, we go beyond death, and by Avidya, we enjoy immortality. Amritam. Amritam. Amrit is also called nectar. It's also called immortality. The word is the same, Amritam. So what is this Avidya through which we enjoy Amritam? By having both together, so you have been enlightened, you realize that there's a constant play of creation, maintenance, and dissolution. Something that you have achieved will be maintained for some time and then it will be broken or dissolved, and something new will be born, maintained, and then broken or dissolved, and that play will go on all your life. So why be in sorrow? Understand it through a greater Vidya, and you will go beyond that sense of loss, sense of death. You will go beyond fear, you will go beyond insecurity, and you will be fresh. So that is Vidya. And what is Avidya? Avidya is expanse. Aham Brahmasmi. I am that source which expands infinitely, which diversifies infinitely, which evolves infinitely. So when we play with the diversity of life, when we play with the colors of life, when we engage in work, when we engage in the yogas, in karma yoga, the yoga of works, the yoga of action, in bhakti yoga, the yoga of great surrender, of great emotional commitment, of great surrender, and through that, through complete commitment, do what we do. If we engage in the yoga of the greater intellect, of wisdom, jnana yoga, from where all is known, if we go through all these yogas, in the play of the diversity of life, in the avidya, with the understanding of vidya, when we have both together, then we enjoy immortality. Immortality is not going into some space which we don't even know about, which we only imagine sometimes. Immortality is where your chitta is still and you are in the play. Like a gymnast, in the Olympics. Imagine the stillness of the mind of the gymnast when they are taking multiple somersaults to hit the water from a diving board straight down with perfect symmetry. How still the chitta of that gymnast is to achieve that miracle of the body. So similarly, we achieve amritam, we achieve immortality, we achieve the great enjoyment of life when we are truly in yoga, when there is no vritti in our chitta. And through that stillness, through that inner union, we can play with everything without being shaken ever. And that is truly how life becomes yoga. All life becomes yoga. So having said that, all very well to think about it and talk about it, but in present circumstances, how do we achieve that? What are the tools that can help us achieve that? So, all of us, today is International Yoga Day. The most obvious thing that comes to our mind is yogasanas, because we see it on TV, we engage with it every year. Today we are doing it at home, many of us, with our families. So the very obvious definition that comes to our mind is yogasanas, pranayama. These are parts of yoga. But I must share with you something beyond that. Yes, I myself do yogic exercises and they are extremely beneficial to us. But I want to let you into a secret, which many of you already know because you do yogasanas. Whenever you do a particular yogasana, a particular pose, immediately after that you do a counter pose. Yoga is also a reconciliation of opposites. Unless you do the counter of what you have just done, life will not be balanced. But remember, that doesn't mean if you do something positive, you do something negative. No, it doesn't mean that. It means there is harmony on both sides of the coin. It means that you have to create harmony from both sides of your being in a physiological sense. To create symmetry, when you bend forward, the next exercise is to bend backward, so that there is harmony equally achieved from both sides, from both perspectives. In one, your eyes, your sight are moving forward and down. In the other, they're moving backward and down from the other side. Reconciliation of opposites, whether it is in a yogasana, whether it is in your body of emotions, whether it is in the way you look at life, one is always reconciling opposites. And the moment you can play with opposites and understand them as the leela of life and be equally comfortable with the opposites, you automatically move closer and closer to the union of the self, and you move closer and closer to being in a state of yogic consciousness. So that's one thing, even about yogasanas. The other thing is, of course, watching one's breath. The moment we become conscious of our breath, we will become conscious of how much our mind moves. Because the moment you start watching your breath, your mind will become quiet. And the moment your mind is not quiet, you will forget to watch your breath. So watching your breath, watching it become deeper, watching it as it is it a short breath? Is it a long breath? Is it a deep breath? Is it a comfortable breath? Are my shoulders tensing while I'm breathing? Is my chest expanding? Is my diaphragm expanding? Is my stomach expanding? So the moment you become observant, the uncalled for thoughts, the uncontrolled thoughts of the mind already are brought attention to. You throw a torchlight on your thoughts, on your subconscious, by this niyam. So this niyam, this yama, this concentration on the breath, a form of meditation again, helps us to stop the vrittis in our mind. Very powerful tool of becoming yogic. Another very, very powerful tool, which sometimes we like to skip, is becoming a corpse. Shavasana. You know, shavasana means the asana of becoming a corpse. Becoming so still, so listless, every muscle so drop dead, in a sense, so relaxed, that all your tensions go away from you. And what do we do during shavasana? Whichever point is tense, we breathe into those points. Lie really still. Feel your whole neck against the floor if you can. Feel your back relaxing. Whichever point is not relaxed, breathe into it. So when you breathe into it, when you watch your breath during such shavasana, you will slowly find that all your muscles become more and more relaxed. And I cannot emphasize the importance of shavasana enough. It is one of the most powerful tools of quietening the body, quietening your muscles, quietening your emotions, quietening your mind. A prerequisite, almost a kind of cleansing, almost like a nyasa, before you go into pranayama and then go into your asanas. So that's one aspect of yoga and one line of practice. I would like to introduce some more forms of yoga. There are so many forms of yoga in our culture. And that's the amritam that we are talking about. The place, we call it avidya, but avidya with the torchlight of vidya, with the torchlight of enlightenment, is a place. All life is yoga. Those plays that are so perfect with the higher mind looking at them. When the higher mind, when the mind filled with vidya is looking at the plays, the diversity, the avidya of life, the maya of life, then every play becomes perfect. So in these plays, when we use the tools of our consciousness, the tools of our mind and body perfectly, then every play becomes yoga. Hatha yoga is one of the yogic plays, the one of the yogic tools which help us to come into union with ourselves. What are the other tools? What are the other yogas that we can use? Many, many yogas. Let's talk about, which I mentioned a little bit earlier, the three psychological or psychophysiological yogas, which are Karma Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, and Jnana. Unless you dirty your hands in the mud, unless you engage in every physical activity or activity in the terrestrial plane, you will not understand the secret of this terrestrial world you live in. You cannot say, I am in yoga, I am in meditation, I want to be a yogi, so these kinds of work are not for me. The moment you try to skip a step in that evolutionary ladder of your consciousness, you have missed the bus. So don't try to skip a step. The real test of your inner union, of your ability to stop the vritti of your chitta, of your bed of consciousness, is when you play with the ifs and buts of your physical life. When you clean your room, when you tidy your room, when you engage with people, when you cook your food, when you go into your garden, when you let your feet be soiled in the mud, these are tests for yourself. What is it that I'm shying away from? What is it that I think is below my dignity? Where are you losing your dignity of labor? So these are tests. Are you a karmyogi? Are you flexible enough in circumstances where there is huge losses? How present you are to your yogic self? How can you reinvent yourself at this moment? How can you think of new and innovative ways of doing work that can lead to positive results? Are we thinking on our feet? Are we being true karma yogis at every moment? So, very important, the basis of all yoga, karma yoga. How can we achieve karma yoga very quickly and very beautifully? Sometimes people think there are different types of yogis, karma yogis, bhakti yogis, jnana yogis. That may be true, but it's not completely true. Because every kind of yogi, whether it is a person who leads himself or herself to the truth through jnana, whether a person comes to yoga through work, or whether a person comes into yoga through great bhakti and surrender, whichever window you begin from, ultimately you will have to encompass all these planes and paths of yoga to become a complete yogi. So, karma yoga or bhakti yoga or jnana yoga may be starting points for different kinds of people. But all the yogas have to be combined for a complete union with life and self. So, bhakti yoga is that huge commitment, that huge love for what you're doing, or huge love for the divine, which makes you do everything perfectly in life. Because of your great love, your great faith, your great surrender, and your great commitment. And Jnana Yoga is that light of mind that sometimes makes you cry. Some of you might have experienced that. When that ray of light of the greatest truth, of the truth of things comes upon you, there are such revelations that they make you. That can change your life at every moment. And jnana yogis, typically people who are stirred by the mind, by truths that they come across, by truths that they hear, by truths that they read, people who follow the line of yoga through jnana, also cannot be in a yogic consciousness in life unless they also adopt karma yogically and live life with complete surrender to the inner truth and to the source, to the light that feeds us at every moment. So all three yogas must come together, whichever starting point you choose. Very, very important. Then I'd like to introduce another kind of yoga very quickly. We had gone into it in great detail last year, but today, because we're talking about the integrality of yoga, I will touch upon various tools. So let's first of all understand that most of the tools that are very easily available to us are through our indriyas. What are the indriyas? The sensory inputs of our being, the sensory channels of our being. What are they? Sight, visualization, smell, taste, hearing, and touch. So these are the indriyas through which we can lead ourselves to yoga. So there's a huge body of knowledge from various cultures, various practices, which are now called isms, whether we say Hinduism or Jainism or Buddhism, it was a composite culture with many practices. Today also there are many, many practices which might in the future become separate isms and separate religions, but at some point the people who founded these practices were people living in this culture who started a certain practice which led them into the union with the self. So mantra yoga, for instance, or nadi yoga, the yoga of vibration, typically we think of it as the yoga of sound, but it's not sound. Nada is all that moves. Na is prana, the bed of prana, and da is agni or ichha shakti, which moves the pranic bed. So nada yoga is a yoga of vibration. And what is vibration? So I would ask the question, what is not vibration? Everything that exists in the universe, even the chair you're sitting on, is made up of cells, made up of atoms, and atoms are vibrational substances, non-solid, which has been proved by quantum physics today. Atoms are non-solid substances in which subatoms are moving in unimaginable speeds every moment. So every single atom in your body is a vibrational entity. There is nothing solid in your body or in any so-called inanimate body. Everything is constantly in movement, constantly in vibration. All that you take in, all that you see, all that you hear, all that you take in through your mouth is turned into atoms and molecules, turned into vibrations at every moment. All that you hear and see and touch and taste goes into your permanent memory. Science has told us in the past that memory is stored in the brain in the form of chemicals. So what is happening? Every vibration that you take into your body becomes your memory, which means chemicals, which means atoms. So everything that you take in becomes a future atom of your body, of your consciousness, of your vibrational consciousness. So how can we use these tools? And let me share briefly with you. There is mudra yoga. So through touch, through the science of touch, we can access our nadis. There are nyasas in my talks, which I give every week on other platforms. We taught one of the Sri Vidya nyasas. Sri Vidya is a Shakti practice. So there are nyasas in which you access all your nadis through the cleansing of your thumb and fingers along with bija mantras. So sounds connect with nadis. Sounds connect with different energy centers. That's the science of bija, the yoga of bija mantras, part of nadi yoga, where all the bijas come from the knowledge of the Sanskrit alphabet. Every line of the Sanskrit alphabet is connected to a different part of your vocal anatomy, right from gutturals, ga, gha, ga, gha, palatals, cha, cha, ja, cha, hitting the palate, cerebrals, ter, ter, der, ter, labials, per, per, ber, ber, dentals, ter, ter, der, ter. So every line of the Sanskrit alphabet is touching a different part of your, different section of your vocal anatomy, and that percussion resonates in different chakras, different parts of the human body, and that becomes also the basis of the Shakti forces within you, the bijas within you. And bijas are using these consonants and these vowels along with a nasal sound or an aspirate visarga to create bija mantras. It's a very, very short definition. But using sound is one of the very powerful ways, and indeed nadi yoga is actually used in every other yoga, every practice in Indic cultures. Whether it's Buddhist, Jain, Hinduism, and so many practices in our culture, every yogic culture uses sound. uses sound to align the body, to harmonize the body. For instance, you have different elemental states, you have the chakras in the body. We won't go into detail today, but beginning with the earth elemental state at the Mooladhara to the rasas, the apaha or the water, so-called in English, elemental state at the Swadhisthana, to the fire or tejas elemental state at the Manipura, to the vayu elemental state at the anahata or the chest heart, to the Vishuddhi chakra, which is the akasha elemental state, and then above that the agnya, which is the agni, the will that controls the elemental states. So according to the elemental states, you have different sounds, different root sounds, different bija sounds, which actually connect with the state of the element. Ha for akasha, ra for fire, wa for water. So these become the root sounds which lead to bijas, which actually resonate in these different parts and cure them. For instance, if you have a throat pain, which some of us might have in the present situation today, if you do hum, 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 you will actually find your throat pain going away. I have not had medicines for the last 32 years and have cured every viral, every state only with bija mantras and of course cleansing. Before you do any kind of yogic activity, whether it is emotional yogic activity, whether it is physical yogic activity, whether it is psychological yogic activity, nyasa, cleansing, is very important. So please, just like you have an outer bath physically, please have an inner bath physically every day. Please have at least 1 liter of water before you brush your teeth every morning. Clean your system. We never give ourselves a bath from inside. How can we avoid disease? Imagine if you didn't give yourself a bath outside for 4 days, what would happen to your skin? So imagine what's happening to your food pipes inside. Imagine what's happening to your bloodstream because you are not giving yourself an inner bath every day. So that is the nyasa, the inner bath that you need to give your body. The neural networks need nyasa. So you need to clean your nadis every day through different nyasas, and you need to clean your emotions, forgive everyone every day. Clean your mind, rudratak, watch your breath, get the thoughts out of your mind, and then use bija mantra, use Vedic chants. Vedic chants, like for instance, we can end with it today. Om Sahana Vavatu, Sahanau Bhunaktu, Sahabiryam Karavavahai, Tejasvinavadhitamastu, Mavidvishavahai. Shanti, shanti, shanti. One more. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. So both these chants, Vedic chants, were intoned only in 3 notes of the musical scale. When I do a workshop, I let you guess, but we don't have so much time, so I'm telling you. Om Sa Purnamada Sanisari Purnamidam Sanisari Purnat Purnamudachyate Nisa Nisa Nisarisa Purnasya Purnamadaya Nisari Nisa Nisari Nisa Nisa Nisarisa Purnamiva Vashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. So when we chant in three notes and go into japa, which means repetition of the chant again and again and again, then we restrict our vibrational movement within three frequencies and undulating in different permutations and combinations only between knee, the lower knee, sa, bass note, and re, slightly higher note. So when you restrict your sound between just three frequencies undulating all the time, then that creates a frequency pulse or a frequency beat, which slows down your brain waves from beta to an alpha meditative state. And further, when you go on chanting, it takes you into an even slower brainwave state called the theta state. And in the theta state, you go into trance. And in trance, when all your nerve fluids withdraw and your outer body and mind become quiet, all your finer energies go in and help with the repair, the inner repair, the harmonization of consciousness, the harmonization of your chakras. So that going within, helped by chanting, by the Vedic chant, help us to come into a yogic consciousness, help us to remove the vrittis or the movements of our chitta, of our bed of consciousness, and help us to come closer and closer to becoming a yogi, to living in yoga, to leading a life of yoga. So maybe we can end together with Om Purnamadah Purnamidam. Wholeness is that, wholeness is this. Purnat Purnamudachyate. From wholeness, wholeness emerges. Purnasya Purnamadaya. Out of wholeness, if we remove wholeness, or if we take out wholeness, or if wholeness is born out of wholeness, what is left behind? Wholeness. Wholeness indeed remains. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Peace, peace. Let's chant together. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Om itself is something that we can adopt in our lives to go into a state of yoga. If you chant the deep breath Om many times, just for 5 minutes every day, you will find many, many, many faculties opening up within you. Great levels of mind, great harmony of the body will be achieved. Stay with the self. Be happy. Play with life. Experiment with life. Knowing that all is transient, everything is constantly being born, everything is constantly dissolving and recreating, innovating, born afresh. Stay with beauty. Stay with renewal of yourself every moment. And that will lead you into yoga. Thank you. I believe we do not have much time, but maybe if we quickly have any questions. See any questions? Okay, so that's wonderful, but lots of beautiful comments. Thank you very much. And it would be wonderful if you have gained anything at all from this sharing between us. Please do share it. Intact has made a lot of effort in bringing this to you on International Yoga Day. So do like the Intact page so that you can be constantly notified of all the work that Intact is doing, and particularly this talk has been brought to you by the Intangible Cultural Heritage Division of Intact. So do like the Intact page so that you can be with us again and again. And with that, I believe we come to the end of our connecting together today. Stay happy. If you are happy, believe me, you will always be safe. Be wise, eat wise, think wise, love all, love yourself. Love all the planes and parts of your life, whether they give you pain or they give you joy, and you will be fresh and beautiful